Thank you very much. I never thought I'll be the chief guest. I think the people who perhaps are in the planning process for the organization, they deserve to give the keynote address. Brief but very clear address. I think I'll be indulging into some random speculations. See, I was told that I have to give a police perspective of what we perceive as the efforts which are necessary for making a city safe. Not from the policing perspective, but what do we expect the others to do, which perhaps will contribute to making our city safer. Both Mr. Kant as well as Dr. Krishna have emphasized the need for governance. I think there is nothing which can better describe a city to be safer than governance. If the city is not well governed, I'm leaving police aside for the time being, the safety cannot be there. That we have seen, whether it is an urban area, whether it is a rural area, if the governance is lacking, the law and order and the crime situation tends to suffer. So from our perspective, well-planned cities where housing, employment, health and primary education is taken care of are the prerequisite for making any city safe. And this must extend to the hinterland also, which Dr. Krishna emphasized, that the rural areas, because if we see the crime pattern in our city, if we, particularly when we analyze our street crime, which we in Delhi, all of us are aware of, apart from the sense of insecurity among women because of the psychological disposition of our male folk, the women on the street feel unsafe because if you are wearing a gold chain, you can become a victim of chain snatching. Similarly, if you are walking in a desolate spot with a mobile phone or in your hand, or if you are carrying some cash in your hand, the possibility of your money being snatched or your purse being snatched or your mobile being snatched is also there. When we see the number of analyze the number of calls in our PCR, almost 25 to 30 incidents take place where somebody loses one's chain or somebody loses one's mobile or somebody is what we can describe as mugged on the streets of Delhi. We have taken some steps, but when we see the people who are committing these crimes, who are they? They are those who do not have adequate means of livelihood. Some of them may be gainfully employed and may take to crime because they want to become rich fast, but most of them, they are those who do not have adequate means of livelihood. Particularly when you see the life life cycle of a chain snatcher. As they say, once a chain snatcher, always a chain snatcher. He will snatch a chain, maybe costing 20,000 rupees. He goes to a jeweler, he gives him 5,000 rupees. He may do two, three snatchings. Invariably, they are known over a period of time. Police, with now technological innovations, catching a criminal is far easier than what it used to be earlier, when only human aid was the only tool which we had to catch a criminal. The person is caught, he is put behind the bars, his family runs around here and there, they go to a lawyer. Lawyer, obviously they don't have money to engage big time lawyers, they go to those who are reasonably in their fees. The lady may not have money, or the sister may not have money. She promises when he comes out, he will pay you fee. After a month, spending month and a half, invariably that is what happens in case of chain snatches. Because it's not a violent crime, though it is a crime which impacts women's sense of security. He comes out, he has no means of livelihood. What does he do? He again goes for chain snatching. He may do two, three chain snatchings and again earns 20,000 rupees or 10,000 rupees. 50% of that goes to the lawyer, 50% goes in taking care of his family needs, and then again police is able to track, pin him down, do some recoveries, because the receiver of stolen property invariably is willing to cooperate with police. Again he is sent behind the bar. So that means if we have to make our cities safe, something more than simple policing, simple planning, urban planning in the shape of buildings and roads and transportation network is required. Mr. Sudhir Krishna mentioned of equity. We have to think in terms of equity. The resources of the state must reach the poorest of the poor. As long as we will have people who will have the need to earn money, chances of some of them getting tempted to commit crime will always be there. Fortunately for us, most of us are decent by nature. That is why we see people sleeping on the street, pulling rickshaws throughout their life, not taking the life of crime. But some of them do fall prey to the temptations. So we have to think in terms of adequate sort of equitable distribution of our nation's wealth, creation of adequate employment opportunities, so that generally people can be taken off. Then we will have taken off from crime, and we will have criminals only those who are, can be termed as white collar criminals, or those who are greedy criminals who may be indulging in some sort of cheatings or economic crimes. This is what my perception is, and also there is a need to sort of improve the faith of our youth in that all of us agree that whatever they are doing is not right. But all of us at times do not agree what was done by the youth, whether they were demanding Lokpal or whether they were demanding some other, or they were protesting on some other issue. They were wrong when they were not abiding by the instructions which were given to them by police. So in my opinion, one, the software of the urbanization, that is emphasis on education, emphasis on healthcare, emphasis on employment generation, that has to be taken care of, and then of course that will come by good governance.